Hello YouTubers, this is Rob Ager of CollativeLearning.com. A few weeks back I asked you to vote for which video project of mine you'd like to see next on YouTube. I gave about 10 choices and by just a handful of votes the winner was a project titled Visual Communication in the Films of Francis Ford Coppola. So I went and studied my three favourite Coppola films, The Conversation, Apocalypse Now and Rumblefish, and realised that just doing a video on visual communication would be quite limited, so I've decided to expand the video into the one that you're now watching. Now some of you might be disappointed that I've limited my study of Coppola to just three of his films and haven't included the Godfather series. But as you'll find in this video, the three films I've chosen for this study are suitable because by comparison to each other, they convey one of Coppola's key filmmaking strengths, his versatility. In fact, I'd say he's probably the most versatile director that I've ever come across. And I'll also add that Coppola himself has stated that The Godfather is just a gangster film at the end of the day. It's not a personal film of his. But the three films I've chosen are personal. So let's first examine the basic plot points of these three films before we start gradually digging deeper into themes and style. Chronologically, The Conversation was the first of the three films to be released and it came out in 1974. The Conversation tells the story of Harry Call, a surveillance expert who is hired by the boss of a corporation to secretly record a conversation between his wife and another man in a crowded park. It turns out that the whole thing is a setup. Harry is being used to bait the company boss into thinking his wife is having an affair so that the boss will try to catch her with her lover in a hotel room, but when the boss gets there, he's murdered. The boss's own assistant, played chillingly by Harrison Ford in an early role, was also in on the plot. Harry witnesses the murder but is unable to do anything about it as all the evidence has been covered up. By the end of the film he descends into surveillance paranoia, thinking he's being watched by the murderers. He tears his apartment to pieces, trying to find surveillance devices but finds nothing. However, Harry was already severely paranoid in the first place. So beneath the basic murder mystery plot is a detailed study of Harry's paranoid character and how he isolates himself from the world. 5 years later, Coppola released his epic war movie Apocalypse Now. I don't really need to say too much about this one because most of you will have seen it, but for those who haven't, here's a rough outline anyway. The film tells the story of Willard, a captain in the US military who is sent on a secret mission in the Vietnam War to kill one of his own, a colonel named Kurtz, who has reportedly gone AWOL with an army of worshippers who consider him a god among men. Escorted by a small boat crew, Willard travels upriver into Cambodia, witnessing various aspects of the war during his travels. When he finds Kurtz, he witnesses the depravity and insanity of the man and his followers and eventually kills him. But mysteriously, Kurtz's followers don't kill Willard. They just let him go. The basic themes of the film are debatable, although most seem to be in agreement that it's sort of a critique of America's involvement in the Vietnam War, as well as an exploration of the insanity of war generally, being that the story is adapted from the novel Heart of Darkness, which was set in colonial North Africa. 4 years after Apocalypse Now, Coppola released Rumblefish, a companion piece to his much more commercial film The Outsiders. Rumblefish tells the story of a teenager, Rusty James, who idolises and tries to imitate his older brother, who is known only as the Motorcycle Boy. The Motorcycle Boy had previously been a gang leader in the neighbourhood and came to be idolised and feared by pretty much everyone because of his vast intellect, fighting ability and wild behaviour. Rusty James has guts, but he's very limited intellectually, so has no chance of living up to his idol. Throughout the story, Rusty learns about his own suppressed trauma of being abandoned for 3 days at the age of two when his mother left and his father went on a drunken, heartbroken bender. He also gradually learns that his brother, despite being idolised, is as unhappy and unfulfilled as Rusty is. The Motorcycle Boy eventually gets killed by a cop who sees him as a severe threat to society. And it's strongly implied that the Motorcycle Boy wanted the cop to kill him and deliberately put himself in that position, a suicide of sorts. So Rusty's idol is now dead and the film ends with Rusty either becoming the new Motorcycle Boy or achieving some sort of self-acceptance and internal peace, depending on how you interpret the final visual metaphors. Alright, so that's the basic plot summaries. So, three films that are very different to each other at the level of basic subject matter: surveillance, war, and youth. So right off the bat it's apparent that unlike most filmmakers, especially genre filmmakers, Francis Coppola was interested in many different aspects of life and was keen to explore them all. So each film project would involve extensive exploration of the subject matter at the production stage, and Coppola didn't just direct. He wrote and revised scripts, he produced, and he worked very closely with talented cinematographers and other long-term collaborators to create the aesthetic styles of his films. For The Conversation, Coppola's research on surveillance technology was accurate enough that it mirrored the technology used in the Watergate scandal, which Coppola claims occurred after The Conversation had already been scripted. Some of the surveillance brand names seen in the convention scenes of the film were also real brand names of the time, such as Pyrolarm, while other company logos and names such as Securitron, with a large capital A, appear to have been fictional. I've been unable to find any such company, but I did find that a company called Securitron, which replaces the A with an I, cites its first major innovation as having occurred in 1977, which was 3 years after The Conversation was released. But technology wasn't the only thing Coppola tapped into for the film. Much more interesting was the psychological dynamics of surveillance. The irony that those who use surveillance to try and gain informational one-upmanship can end up making themselves feel less informationally secure because the information they secretly acquire is often incomplete and merely leads to more questions. Lead character Harry also lives in constant fear that others are accessing information about his own activities. Particularly, he suspects this of his market competitors in the surveillance field. And that must be true in real life for these people. And then there's the ultimate irony, the severely disadvantaged position that a person or organization can find themselves in when the subject they believe they are eavesdropping on knows that they are being watched or listened to, but the eavesdropper doesn't know it. All the subject has to do is deliver false and misleading information while under surveillance, knowing full well that the eavesdropper will believe it totally and act upon it. In fact, that has historically been a crucial psychological operation tactic that has swung the odds in entire wars. And today many people are doing this with social media, scrambling the data that is gathered about them on behalf of corporations and government departments. And good on them. The film also addresses the moral dilemma that is generally present for all surveillance technicians, the question of whether the results of eavesdropping by contract are used for the greater good or are used to facilitate crimes by the contractors or their associates. It's a question that must constantly be on the mind of all professional surveillance operatives, and, like Harry Cole, in order to do the job, they have to submit to a code of immorality, while convincing themselves that they are merely being impartial. In other words, they become surveillance mercenaries. So The Conversation partially served as an educational piece to show the audience just how sophisticated surveillance technology was becoming, yet it also reveals the psychological weaknesses of those who rely on surveillance. With Apocalypse Now, the pre-production research extended into multiple aspects of the Vietnam War, from military equipment to command chain psychology, to the use of drugs and other forms of entertainment for soldiers, and especially in the extended scenes of the Redux version, which I really like though a lot of others don't, the film includes an exploration of broader historical factors that framed the US involvement in the conflict.
After the Japanese War, your President Roosevelt didn't want the French people to stay in Indochina. So, new Americans implanted the Viet Minh.
Yeah, that's true. The Viet Cong were invented by the Americans, sir.
And if it had been known to Coppola at the time, he could have included a reference to the now admittedly staged Tonkin Gulf incident. The film also explores to some extent how human conviction and persistence can defeat technology in warfare. It's not easy to notice, but the dossier on Colonel Kurtz includes a letter written by Kurtz which describes the US as the world's greatest technocracy. Later on, Kurtz talks to Willard of his admiration of the will of the enemy and his desire to imitate and surpass that level of will. So Apocalypse Now is quite an educational film too, showing how military equipment and procedures can fail or be misused or defeated by a committed enemy. With Rumblefish, Coppola appears to have centred his research mostly on aesthetic style, and the film is awesome in that respect. The emulation of film noir visuals is superb and can be enjoyed on that level alone. But unlike The Conversation and Apocalypse Now, the film's lack of specific historical context makes it less obviously an educational piece. But musically and visually, the film has elements spanning many decades of American youth, so there's sort of a timeless educational element to it, some aspects of which we'll explore in this video. The notion of themes that span many times and places is present in all three films. The surveillance themes of the conversation are as true today as they were in the early days of cryptography and cryptanalysis, which go back centuries. The war mentality themes of Apocalypse Now are relevant to the historically earlier context of the source novel, and they're still relevant in war today. With Rumblefish, the theme of an individual trying to imitate an illusionary idol is as important as any other theme in Coppola's whole filmography, because nearly all of us fall into that trap at some point in our lives, especially when we're young, and this is both the film's biggest strength and failure. Audiences don't like having their own psychological weaknesses revealed to them, at least not too overtly, and so denial gets in the way. So when a movie like Rumblefish comes along and presents a young central character who's nowhere near as gifted as he wants to be, teenagers will refuse to identify with that character because teenagers are usually in a psychological development phase of their own, trying to define a future for themselves in which they can have strong influence over their own life and the world. They're testing themselves to find out how capable they are, and so, understandably, they don't want to hear of limitations. So this was a key commercial failing of Rumblefish. Coppola was trying to make an art film for kids, but the messages were too cynical for teenagers to face up to. Instead, the false idol theme is something that older viewers are more likely to appreciate, being that they can look back on the illusions of their own youth and say, "Yeah, I overestimated myself too." By the way, I'm not saying that all teenage aspirations are stupid illusions. Some of my young aspirations, even from childhood, eventually were achieved later in life, despite critical discouragement from small-minded people. But the kind of everyone is going to be in complete and utter awe of me aspirations held by millions of kids who aren't offering anything but their own second-take impression of today's pop stars and movie stars is actually quite dangerous. The aspiration for superstardom distracts kids from pursuing much more worthwhile goals based upon their own actual strengths. To that effect, I consider Rumblefish an important film. It challenges the stereotype youth aspirations depicted in movies like, say, Dirty Dancing or even The Karate Kid. Those movies sell illusions, but Rumblefish sells an unpleasant reality. Despite the overt subject matter differences between Coppola's films, there are also thematic crossovers between them. Is there really any core psychological difference between the village attack battle scene of Apocalypse Now and the two street fights seen in Rumblefish? In both films, the violence is flashy and stylized according to how the deluded fighting parties view themselves as basking in the glory of victory. Or how about the similarities of paranoia and isolation experienced by Harry Cole in The Conversation, Colonel Kurtz in Apocalypse Now, and the cynical loner motorcycle boy in Rumblefish? Each of these thought-obsessive characters has created a bubble for themselves through which they see the whole world around them as an illusion not to be trusted, including the people in it. And is there really much difference between the secret plot to murder Kurtz in Apocalypse Now, the secret plot to kill a company boss in The Conversation, or the cop's plot to kill the motorcycle boy in Rumblefish? They're all murders, and both the motorcycle boy and Kurtz are killed because they are viewed as crazies who incite others to unnecessary violence and are placed on a pedestal by mistake. Note also that Harrison Ford played one of the key conspirator roles in the murders of Kurtz in Apocalypse Now and the company boss in The Conversation. What a coincidence! So despite the contextual differences of the films, similar core aspects of human nature are being explored. Coppola related to Susie Hinton's source novel of Rumblefish because, like lead character Rusty James, he also had idolised his older brother in his youth. So Francis chose his older brother's son, his own nephew Nicholas Coppola, to play the role of Smokey. For those of you who are confused, yes, that is Nicholas Cage, the nephew of Francis Coppola, before he had his name changed. Francis even had Nicholas wear the same jacket that Nicholas's own father had worn in his youth. So basically, Nicholas was playing his own real-life father. In the film, Smokey is Rusty James's intellectually superior friend, a boy who was much more likely than Rusty to become the next neighbourhood idol. So we have a strong personal touch from Coppola in this film regarding his own family history. As is outlined in the behind-the-scenes documentary Heart of Darkness, Francis had one hell of a time getting Apocalypse Now made. In fact, it's a huge testament to him that he managed to do it, whether the film was any good or not. He had to become a bit of a crazy Colonel Kurtz-like figure in order to get the colossal production finished. Though the earliest versions of the script were bashed out by John Milius, Coppola and other filmmakers of the time, including Spielberg and George Lucas, are cited as having been involved in the conceptualization of the story. But even as the film was being made, Coppola was rewriting scenes, adding new scenes and so on, personalizing the film. And it's no accident at all that he has a bit part as a filmmaker in the movie, directing soldiers to move about in a false orchestration of battle.
Look at the camera! Don't look at the camera! Just go by like you're fighting! Like you're fighting! Don't look at the camera! It's a television! Just go through! Go through! Just go by! Keep going!
It's debatable what Francis was communicating by depicting himself in this way, but he was certainly communicating something. So again, the film is personalised on certain levels. With the conversation, there doesn't seem to be much overt evidence of a personal touch, but Coppola was the scriptwriter, the sole scriptwriter, and was not working from a source novel. This was a story he created from scratch based on personal opinions and research. And in the scenes of Harry mucking about with audio recording and editing equipment or viewing himself on CCTV screens, I couldn't help but think of Coppola himself recording and editing his own films. But even more personal to Coppola is that in this dream sequence, the main character talks of some childhood experiences, which Coppola has since revealed were essentially autobiographical.
I was very sick when I was a boy. I was paralyzed in my left arm and my left leg. Couldn't walk for 6 months.
So on the whole, that's something I really like in these three films. Coppola goes for grandiose themes that are relevant to many people, times and places, yet he also manages to imprint intimate aspects of his own life. The films are both personal and universal. Okay, let's start getting into the aesthetics and technicalities. There's a hell of a lot to say about the finer details of these films, but I'm going to mostly restrict myself here to observations of how Coppola altered his aesthetic style between films in a way that, in my opinion, even surpassed Stanley Kubrick. With Kubrick, the subject matters changed a lot between films, but the basic use of wide shots, long, unedited takes, among other things, remained consistent whether he was shooting a trip to the moon or a drill sergeant breaking in some new recruits. Francis, on the other hand, had a unique ability to alter almost any aspect of his filmmaking technique between projects, but most important was that he did so in a way that was in keeping with the subject matter and themes of whatever film he happened to be making. So let's explore that now in detail. The comparisons of how Francis used light and colour in these three films are impressive. In The Conversation, Harry is trapped in an isolated, emotional prison of his own making. So much of the film is shot at night, resulting in lots of dark areas in the sets and silhouettes of characters. When artificial light is used, it's often kept minimal. A small table lamp, light spilling out of a kitchen, and so on. Harry himself tries to be a shadow, invisible to the world yet all-seeing, so the dark visuals are appropriate. The colour palette tends also to be dominated by greys and browns wherever possible, given Harry's emotional disconnection, as well as the cold-blooded mentality of corporate bosses in their dull grey buildings. An interesting splash of rare colour in the film is when Harry is sat in the corporate office block, waiting to pass on a set of recordings to the company director. But the director's assistant is trying to prevent him from meeting the director. The sofa is bright red, and it stands out like a sore thumb. Harry knows something is wrong, and he's getting angry. So, a moment later, he snatches the recordings back. Now, was the red sofa selected as an indication of Harry's angry emotional state? I thought I was probably reading too much into this, but later on, when the assistant is following Harry and delivering veiled warnings that he wants the recordings back, he too is sat on a bright red sofa. This time, he's the angry one. What are the odds? Compare the bland coloration and dark lighting of The Conversation to that of Apocalypse Now, which is full of garish colour and bright light, almost to the point of psychedelia. Coloured smoke was used as a signal system in Vietnam for things like letting chopper pilots know how safe it is to land in a particular zone. Hence we see a couple of yellow caution smoke grenades where an extraction chopper lands then gets blown up by surprise. Most movies about the Vietnam War don't bother showing these colour-coded smoke systems, but they're used extensively in Coppola's film, both for realistic portrayal and for visual artistry. Lance, for example, is spaced out and uses a smoke grenade to enhance his trip. Coloured smoke is also used to give Kurtz's compound a surrealist feel. No chopper would ever be able to land here anyway. In the scenes of Kurtz, Coppola had to improvise quite a bit because actor Marlon Brando had put on a ton of weight. And one of the things he did was to make thematic use of the fact that we hardly see Kurtz. Kurtz is presented in silhouettes, elusive godlike shadow that he is. His face is seen in visually deforming half-lip forms, and body doubles are used in some wider shots to make his physical frame more impressive. A lot of people criticised this part of the film, but I think Coppola's compromises were very well thought out, and possibly better than what was originally planned in the script. Kurtz ends up being visually comparable to the stone idols of the ruins that he and his followers live in, and the flame-lit coloration of the scenes and the bars of smoky light enhance the sense of having entered some spiritual realm. I like it. And now time for a short commercial break. If you've been enjoying this Francis Ford Coppola analysis, then before you watch the rest of it, listen up. For all you freeloaders out there, Robbie has got two YouTube channels. That's right, two. And between them, there's a ton of videos on film analysis and psychology and all kinds of shit. And for those of you who can read, get your asses over to Rob's website, collativelearning.com, where you'll find some seriously in-depth articles on The Shining, 2001 A Space Odyssey, A Clockwork Orange, Texas Chainsaw Massacre, and Revenge of the Nerds, plus all kinds of shit that'll take you hours to get through. And for those of you who want to go a lot deeper and discover life's true meaning, find out who the hell you are, Robbie has got nearly 10 times as much stuff available to order as digital downloads. That's right, digital downloads. You pick what you want, you click I want this, you pay with credit card or PayPal, if the PayPal feature isn't broken on the day, because sometimes that happens, then you'll get an email with a link to what you ordered, and you download the damn thing. Videos, articles, audio files, even pizza, downloaded straight to your hard drive. Just check out some of these examples of what's on offer for freeloaders and buyers. Film analysis of The Warriors, Dread, Full Metal Jacket, The Big Lebowski, Death Wish 2, RoboCop, and plenty more. And now back to the main show. As if the huge contrast in light and coloration between The Conversation and Apocalypse Now wasn't enough, Rumblefish goes for a different approach again. Coppola and his team, shooting this time in black and white, borrow heavily from film noir style, even literally painting dramatic shadows onto parts of the sets. But the black and white choice isn't just a cliched way of making the film appeal to arthouse audiences. Rusty's older brother is colourblind, so it's kind of like we're seeing Rusty's self-deluded world through the revealing eyes of the motorcycle boy. Silhouettes and shadows are used extensively, such as to portray the ever-watchful eye of the neighbourhood cop, and to introduce Rusty's father, an alcoholic, empty shell of a man, a shadow of his former self before his wife left him. In the first fight scene, light is used very effectively. The fight occurs near a train track, and the introduction of Rusty's rival is dramatically enhanced by a train flying past from the same direction as Biff and his gang. The flashing lights of the moving train carriages are used to add tension, and those same flashing lights are used throughout the fight, even when there aren't any trains actually passing by. It's a very sneaky subliminal trick. And then of course there's the thematic use of coloured fish to make them really stand out against everything else being black and white.
The colours are cool.
Mm-hmm. Makes me kinda sorry I can't see the colours.
In the film's only moments of full colour filming, Rusty James has just let the fighting fish loose in the river and discovered that they aren't killing each other. Then he sees the police siren in colour and punches out the car window.
Okay, buddy, you're going downtown.
Now this makes conceptual sense in relation to the coloured fish. When he put the fish in the river, he found out that his brother's prediction that the fish wouldn't fight if they weren't imprisoned was true. And Rusty gets the metaphor, which is a big leap forward in his thinking because throughout the film he's regularly confused by symbolism as described by others.
Man, what the fuck did the Greeks have to do with anything, huh?
Yeah, I didn't get to the ocean.
No?
No, I didn't get to the ocean. California got in the way.
California got in the way? I thought California was on the coast.
Obviously, the motorcycle boy was talking here about not finding happiness in California because he sees it as a society that's drowning in its own delusions.
Yeah, California's like a beautiful wild girl on heroin. Whose high is it, Kite? thinking she's on top of the world, not knowing she's dying even if you show her the marks.
Rusty finally understands that the rumblefish in the pet store who attack each other and their own reflections are a symbolic equivalent of himself and other fighting kids caged up in a downtrodden neighbourhood. And it angers him, hence the first colour thing he sees is the angry flashing red of the police siren. Remember that point earlier about the use of red to represent anger in the conversation? Well, this time the colour metaphor is much harder to dismiss. Rusty sees himself reflected in colour, and like the colourful fish trying to attack their own reflections, he attacks his reflection. But unlike the fish, he smashes his reflection, the destruction of his old identity. It's a beautiful scene, but if you're not paying attention to what the colour symbolism means, then it just seems like pretentious arthouse garbage. Okay, so those are some examples of how Coppola makes varied use of light and colour from one film to the next. Before we move on to the topic of camera work, I just want to make further mention of smoke symbolism. I already outlined the psychedelic use of coloured smoke in Apocalypse Now. Well, we get this in both of the other films we've been exploring. In The Conversation, huge amounts of smoke are used in the dream sequence, both to establish the unreal dream setting, but also to establish the mental fog of the main character, his feeling of being lost because he doesn't have enough information about what's going on around him. And in Rumblefish, smoke is cross-symbolised with time-lapse cloud footage. In many shots we see speeding and rolling clouds, implying the timeless setting and the notion of kids throwing away years of their lives on street fighting nonsense. But we're also given frequent subliminal reminders of these themes by the presence of incidental white smoke in some of the sets and locations. Camera work is another area in which Coppola and his team dramatically switch styles between these three films. The first few minutes of The Conversation are seen specifically from the point of view of a surveillance device, even though the operator is actually only recording audio. And as we begin switching to standard cinematic presentation, the impression of surveillance is subtly maintained by the use of distant zooms, like the viewer is eavesdropping too. This blurring of standard narrative cinematography with surveillance imitation cinematography continues throughout the film. Cold stationary shots are positioned like watchful, hidden eyes. In his apartment, Harry is concerned that his landlord knows too much about his personal life and has access to his apartment. As he chastises her about this over the phone, he appears to be trying to escape the viewing field of the very film itself. And each time he does so, the camera waits a moment, then robotically tracks him to wherever he has moved to. As he's being emotionally probed by a woman who turns out to be a honey trap operative, we get a swooping camera movement from her to him, repeated. I've never seen a straight dialogue scene filmed like this, so it's more than likely another of the film's uses of robotically repeated camera movements, as we'd expect in CCTV footage. In the film's ending, Harry has stripped his apartment bare but failed to find any surveillance devices, while the one surveillance device he can never see continues to track back and forth between he and his apartment, the film camera itself. Like all characters in all fiction movies, he is under surveillance, so to speak. Looking at Rumblefish compared to The Conversation, there's very little in terms of camera work to suggest that the two films were even directed by the same person. Contrasting with the rigid and stiff shots of The Conversation, Rumblefish's cinematography is loose and dynamic. The fight scenes, near-death sequence and cycle sequence are filmed with low angles for drama, high angles to give a hawk's eye take on the proceedings, swooping angles for energy, and tilted angles for disorientation. These scenes are very engaging on a raw visceral level, and perhaps if more of the film had that kind of overt dynamism, it might have been more commercially popular. There's also an unusually high number of wide-angle shots, especially in dialogue scenes. Usually this involves a particular character standing close and facing the camera as they listen to other characters who are distant and out of sight behind them, yet visible to us. It gives the impression of characters being emotionally isolated from each other. It may even be a deliberate reference to the wide-angled vision of fish. After all, very wide-angled camera lenses are often called fisheye lenses, and the characters are the human equivalent of rumblefish, which have to be kept isolated from each other in tanks. These wide-angled shots are a great little subtlety that doesn't seem to be used at all in The Conversation or Apocalypse Now. Speaking of Apocalypse Now, the cinematography is much more varied, being that the film itself chronologically goes through many different conceptual and emotional phases. So as Willard is introduced, his head is shown upside down and overlapped with footage of explosions, sort of implying that his mind has been messed up and turned upside down by the war itself. Footage of a ceiling fan is used to imply that the war is buzzing in his head like a loose helicopter. When he's given his delicate mission, we get lots of close-ups of eyes, faces, and even hands. Particular attention is given to Willard, especially in close-ups. And I think the reason for all these close-ups generally is to put the emotions of the characters on display, in contrast to the fact that they are overtly trying to play down their emotions to each other. And I love the unusual touch of the scene ending with the camera simply panning to the window before cutting to the first exterior shot, and then cracking on with Willard and his mission out in the big wide world that the high-level officers hardly ever get to see. The use of close-up shots and dialogue scenes overall is great because it enhances the emotional qualities of the acting in general without the actors having to ham it up like they would on a stage. It allows actors to be more subtle, yet in the bigger set pieces such as the battles we get an opposite approach. Everything becomes big, wide, panoramic shots, especially the godlike views of Vietnam from the skies, which is sort of akin to how war planners view things on their maps, from a great distance where they never have to look right up in the face of a person who is suffering or dying, not even their own troops. So in the battle scenes, suffering infants are only shown briefly and from a distance, and we only get a couple of brief instances of a person in agony from their wounds. Interesting that they chose a black actor as being the only American troop who is overtly shown suffering in the village attack scene, perhaps a comment about the mass drafting of black Americans into the war. This poor fella has had his guts shot out, and the emotional disconnection of the soldiers around him is conveyed by the distance of the camera itself. We get a similar thing at the Kurtz compound. Dead and dying bodies, stripped naked and probably tortured quite severely, are shown either from a distance, with their backs to us, or out of focus. Again, it conveys the ambivalence to human suffering that is a central facet of Kurtz and his followers, and no doubt the desire to avoid fights with the censors played a role in the way these bodies are filmed. On the whole, the huge variation in shot sizes from one scene to the next gives visual dynamism, allowing the film to alternate between the deeply personal and coldly impersonal aspects of the war experience. There's tons more to say about the cinematography in Apocalypse Now, but I'll just mention one other point. I love the out-of-focus slow-motion helicopters in the opening shot of the film. To me, the choppers are like steel insects buzzing about in the jungle. Coming from a family of people who are involved in the creative arts, Coppola has a really good knowledge of music, and its presence in his films. His father was a composer and scored several of Francis's films, and together this father and son team created the hypnotic score for Apocalypse Now. All sorts of subtle elements are at work here. The use of echo effects enhances the dreamlike emotional disconnection of Willard and Kurtz, and it adds to the sense of Vietnam's open geographical space in the helicopter scenes. Even the drone-like sounds of helicopter blades are incorporated into the score, emphasising the machine-like nature of the US military presence in Vietnam. Of course, the Coppolas didn't compose The Ride of the Valkyries for the village attack scene, that's an old classical piece, but its inclusion was a clever stroke on Francis's part. Anyone brainwashed into admiring violence would take enjoyment in this horrific battle scene, but to most of us the Wagner music obviously communicates the sense of artificial glory in battle. Less obvious to casual viewers is that Wagner's composition relates to death on the battlefield and the selection of brave souls of the dead for entry to Valhalla, and thus immortality. Immortality through self-sacrificial death in battle is a weird aspect of military psychology that has spanned the centuries and taken many forms. Even in communist regimes that claim atheism yet convince people to sacrifice themselves for the good of the state, as if the state were God. hence the contradiction between religion and communism in the Viet Cong. Ho Chi Minh, for example, was the name chosen by the Cong leader, which translates as He Who Enlightens, a spiritual concept right at the apex of Vietnamese communism. Note also that we see a couple of Vietnamese praying for an injured US soldier in the village attack scene. Another dynamic of the Wagner music is that it allows Coppola to show us horrific things without disengaging us too much from wanting to watch the film. The horrors of war are represented, such as the school kids being rushed away, suggesting that some or all of them are likely to be killed in the attack, being that almost every building is blown up. But the horror of what is going on is initially offset by the upbeat music. And it's this same school play area which is the setting for the point where the glorious music ends, the smoke gives way, and the horror and suffering of death in the battlefield is shown, stripped of its glorious delusions. Welcome to the real Valhalla. In terms of sound, it's notable here that the screams of dying soldiers are given equal volume to what should be the much louder sound of the chopper exploding. Sonically, that's unrealistic, but it emphasises the human suffering rather than the action. Something else I love about the Apocalypse Now score is that it fuses primal sounding instrumentation with technological effects, such as echoes and chopper blades, as I mentioned earlier. We get bare bones incidental music like Mr. Clean drumming away with a couple of sticks like he's taking part in some tribal ritual. It underhandedly adds to that sense that we're delving into primal territory.
The President of the United States, baby. That's what I'm doing.
He's really specialising in busting my balls.
And we get a brief inclusion of an electronic version of Holst's Mars, the Bringer of War. Again, the tribal combined with the technological, as well as the obvious war reference. In another instance, we hear what sounds like electronic circus music in a chaotic night location. I've never been able to decide whether that music is supposed to be incidental to the scene, because the echo effects make it sound like part of the location. Apocalypse Now is one of the most multi-layered and intricate films I've ever come across in terms of sound. Over to Rumblefish and we get a very different sounding score, this time by Stuart Copeland of The Police, and no doubt he worked closely with Francis on this. The lyrics for the title song of the film are actually a really good summary of the film's symbolic structure. Copeland must have filled him in on the symbols that would be at work. Elsewhere, the music has a crossover with Apocalypse Now in that its percussion and drums often have a slightly tribal feel, this time the tribes being street gangs, of course. The score also incorporates incidental sound effect elements such as the horns of trains in Rusty's fight scene. Typewriters.
You start at Cleveland next Monday, Rusty. You're suspended till then.
Ticking clocks and watches in relation to the film's theme of lost time. And car horns. This fusion of sound effects with music is a good general approach because when a musical score sounds distinctly separate from the incidental sounds of the scenes, it feels kind of false. In fact, I find most of the best movie composers use this blending approach of working their compositions around the incidental sound effects so that the two work together. Like with Apocalypse Now, Rumblefish uses a lot of echo effects in its sound, firstly to enhance the sense of emotional separation between characters, but also to convey the effect of distant memories. For example, the faint and distant sound of Rusty and the motorcycle boy as kids. And note that the very elusive mother figure who we never get to see is faintly heard as she leaves the family for good, slamming the door on her way out.
That's how you developed your fear of being alone.
You never told me that before.
Hold it right there, sex man.
These are beautiful subtleties, easily missed by the morons who'd watch a movie like Rumblefish and complain that there's not enough action in it. The kind of people who only notice things if they're thumped on the head by them. In the conversation, we again get originality and subtlety in the use of sound and music. The jazz and piano score is gorgeously haunting, and the fact that some of it is actually played by the lead character makes it a very personal thing. The music is the sound of his emotions. The distortions of incomplete dialogue recorded through surveillance serve as both a plot element, and they convey Harry's own confusion in trying to make sense of a world in which he can never have all the information. There's also a repeated metaphor in that the couple he was listening in on at the start of the film discussed the presence of a homeless man.
Oh, look, that's terrible.
It's not hurting anyone.
Every time I see one of those old guys, I always think the same thing.
What do you think?
I always think that he was once somebody's baby boy. I think he was once somebody's baby boy, and he had a mother and a father who loved him, and now there he is, half dead on a park bench. And where are his mother or his father, all his uncles now?
This dialogue, having been recorded, is heard several times in conjunction with shots of Harry, another lost soul who was once someone's little baby boy.
I think he was once somebody's baby boy, and he had a mother and a father who loved him, and now there he is, half dead on a park bench. And where are his mother or his father, all his uncles now?
So incidental dialogue is being used to make direct verbal statements about Harry himself. So all around we get marvellous emotional and thematic use of sound in Coppola's films. Okay, I'm going to finish with the detailed study for now. I was going to talk more in this video about other things, but this video is already longer than I intended it to be, and I've got enough material to produce probably a 1 hour video for each of these films on its own. So I'll finish with one point that I think is key to Coppola's talent, as it is with many other great film directors. Coppola somehow manages to make films that are deeply meaningful on many levels, but it's rare that he becomes ham-fisted with his metaphors. Unlike lesser filmmakers, he doesn't insult the audience's intelligence by overstating things on a regular basis, even when commercial success with casual audiences is dependent on it. And if he does overstate things, he'll at least make sure that there's usually something else going on, something subtle beneath the obvious. Of the three films we've explored here, only Apocalypse Now was a commercial success. The Conversation was wisely praised by critics, but audiences didn't flock to see it. They probably also found it too slow because half of it was going over their heads, or was simply too depressing. Maybe the title of the film was too bland in itself. And the reaction to Rumblefish's minimal release was disinterest and confusion, yet the film has acquired a devout following because it was way ahead of its time and probably still is. As stated earlier, Coppola considers these two his greatest films, and I agree with him. Coppola has received a lot of criticism over the years for his commercial failures with certain films, but the way I see it, in between the more commercial stuff like the Godfather films and The Outsiders or Peggy Sue Got Married, he made worthy sacrifices to create deeper works of art that will be watched with much more appreciation, talked about, studied and learned from further down the line, rather than just filling a few pockets full of money in the short term, as is the purpose of most movies. The box office mercenaries are virtually always quickly forgotten, or, even worse, remembered as artistically empty vessels. Thanks for watching, I'm Rob Ager. If you enjoyed this, then hit that subscribe button. If you have film buff friends who like Coppola's work, then pass on the video link to them. And be sure to read the many film analysis and other articles on my site and check out my back catalogue of offline materials, to which I'll be adding some more in-depth analysis of Coppola films in the future. Adios.